Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the MetaMath webinars. Today, it's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Katia Bertoldi from Harvard University. Katia is going to talk about the multistable inflatable origamis. Katia, please.
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation. Thanks for organizing this seminar series, and thanks everyone for taking the time to join this seminar. So today in this talk, I will tell you about a recent effort in my group on the design of a multistable inflatable origami, and we'll see how this structure can be used both for realize the probable structure as well as simple machines, impulse robots. So this talk is going to be about, so the slide don't advance. Let's give, hopefully it's just a temporary issue.
Just click on it and
yeah,
it will work
so,
after that.
Yeah, let's wait, hopefully. I mean, at the moment, not, they don't advance. Yes, all right. So this is a talk about, you know, the importance of geometry and the importance of structure in achieving functionality. And somehow nature for millions of years has used structure to achieve extraordinary properties. So here a couple of examples. This is a deep sea sponge. And if you look at the architecture, you find a square lattice with a sort of a periodic reinforcement. And what has been shown is this provide strength, provide robustness, structural stability. On the other hand, I mean, you know, nature also use structure to realize color as well as adhesion. So these are examples coming from nature, but also us as humans for millennia, for thousands of years, we have been using geometry to enhance the property of material. And here is a simple example. Think of building. Over thousands of years, we move from the pyramid to this incredible skyscraper. And all this by using geometry to take advantage, to amplify the properties of the materials. A structure are not only buildings and not only bridges, structure are everywhere around us at different scales. So, you know, an umbrella is a simple example of a deployable structure. But we also have been, you know, we also designing structure to direct sound. And these are, you know, foams that we put on the walls when we want to control the propagation of sound. We design and we use simple structure to absorb energy, to protect the object that we want to ship. As well as, you know, we design structure at different scale. And, you know, if we want to go at the micro nano scale, then we can also think of designing structure to control light. So to conclude this overview, what I want to say is that in my group, we are very excited about structure. I was trained as a structural engineer. And what we do, we combine theoretical, computational, and experimental tools to design nonlinear structures, highly deformable structures, that take advantage of deformation to achieve new functionalities and or to achieve unusual properties. And here you can see a few examples from research that we carry out over the years. So we have been using nonlinearities, instabilities, and structure to design material with unusual properties. Here on the top left, in this case, negative Poisson ratio. We have been using geometry to design soft actuator with target motions. We have been using geometry and bistability to design energy absorbing system as well as reconfigurable structure. And also, you know, we have been using geometry to design nonlinear structure capable of guiding mechanical signal, nonlinear, large amplitude waves. And today I want to focus on a special class of structure, and these are inflatable structures. Think of a balloon, right? A party balloon. You inflate it and then you have a simple balloon, and as a kid, you love to play with it. But you know, inflatable structures are not only toys for kids, and also have been proven useful to design temporary structure, both for aerospace and for civil use. And in these recent years, inflatable structure has also been used as a platform to realize simple machine in soft robots, soft actuators, so compliance inflatable object that can perform simple tasks. And those have become quite popular because they are inexpensive, and typically they are flexible, and so they can interact also with delicate, fragile objects. All right, all this is good. But now, if you think of both inflatable structural architectural scale and inflatable actuator, clearly they are very different. They have very different functionality. They are also a very different scale, but they also share some features. For example, if you look at the pressure volume curve of this structure, all of them are characterized by a quite smooth curve, very similar to that of a balloon. And as a result, their energy landscape is monosonic and characterized by a single minima in correspondence of the basically initial state, undeformed, uninflated, deflated state. All right. So what does this imply? Well, this implies that if we have an inflatable structure, we need to maintain the pressure on if we want to keep the deployed shape. So as soon as we remove the input, the structure deflates. And in terms of actuator, this means that, you know, if I apply a certain, since the PV curve is very smooth and energy also cool very smooth, when I apply a certain volume, I only get one output. So there is a one-to-one correspondence between input and output. And if I want to have multiple output, it means that I need to have multiple input. So typically, this soft robot, you see many tubes coming in because you need to actuate them, the individual actuator individually, in order to achieve a certain sequence and a certain functionality. Now, the question we ask is, how about if we, can we alter the energy landscape of the structure? For example, how about if we design, what can we get if we design a bistable energy landscape? An energy landscape, you can see here, with two minima, minimum in corresponding initial state, but also another minima. You can see here. So what happens if we basically introduce bistability? What can we get out of this structure? And this is what I'm going to focus on. And before going into the specific of the project, what we expect is for the architectural structure, what we expect is this structure, we hope to achieve structure that can retain their deployed shape, even when the input is, the input pressure is removed. And in terms of actuator, we hope to be able, by introducing a multi-well energy landscape, we hope to be able to achieve arbitrary output also when we apply a single input pressure. And just to put in this into context, multi-stability, the ability to have multiple stable configuration, as in recent years, as a power platform to realize smart structure and structure with new functionality. And here are three examples. So DAC Hall must be used, used by stability, for example, to design tunable optic system. Lorenzo Valdevita, UC Irvine, has used multi-stability to design shape changing structure. And the last example here on the right comes out of Chiara D'Araio, Caltech, and she has used bistability to design a simple robot that can propel itself. And so today I want to focus. So now, to realize multi-stable structure, clearly there are multiple platforms we can use. You know, we know that there are multiple building blocks that leads to bistability and multi-stability. And for the project I'm going to show you, we have decided to focus on origami. And why origami? Well, we believe origami is a promising platform to realize multi-stable and inflatable structure. First of all, this has been shown by many groups that, you know, origami provide a platform for deployable structure by introducing a set of folds in a sheet. What you can get structure that can dramatically change their volume and can go from a flat configuration to an arbitrary 3D configuration. And further, it has been shown that this structure can also be actuated using using pressure. And further on, what has been shown is that by carefully choosing the folding pattern, you can also achieve multi-stability. So you can realize structure with multiple stable configuration. All right. So for today, I want to focus specifically on two projects where we have exploited inflatable bistable origami. And in the first project, we'll use inflatable origami as a platform to design large-scale inflatable structure. And in the second project, instead, we'll use an array of these bistable inflatable modules to realize simple robotic systems. So let's start with the focusing on the first project. So the first project, we focus on a deployable structure. And this is a work that was led by my postdoc Ben, my student David, and it's a collaboration with Chuck Oberman, who is at the Graduate School of Design. And in this picture here, you can see a young Chuck in front of the university. All right. So what is a deployable structure? A deployable structure is a structure that has a compact state that is ideal for transportation and then can be deployed for functionality. And now, if we can think about the feature that we would like this deployable structure to satisfy, well, we would like them to occupy the minimum possible volume when folded, because so it's easier to transport them and also to storage them. Then we would like them also, if possible, to provide a robust shell, because typically they are used when they are in use, we want them to provide a protective environment. We also would like them to lock in place after deployment. So we would like them to be able to retain their deployed space, their deployed shape. And finally, also very importantly, we would like to be easy to deploy. We would like to deploy without much human help. So now many strategies have been proposed to satisfy this requirement. And the most popular probably is the linkage-based structure. And here in this picture, you can see an example of linkage-based structure. Now, they're very popular, they are used on a daily basis, but they also have limitations. So, for example, if you want to obtain a protective environment, you need to add a membrane on top of the frame. So, it's, the shell comes by adding an additional component. Lock in place after the deployment typically require positioning a screw of additional elements. And regarding the deployment, you need to sync all these elements, and typically you run into issues because they don't sync properly. But one of the engines gets stuck, and then you need to act manually to basically work it out. So what we try to see is if inflatable origami could somehow solve some of these limitations. So here is our simple building block. It's a triangle. ABC are the vertices. Alpha and beta are the internal angles. And then what we do to deploy this triangle, we rotate it with respect to the around the edge BC. And here is the crucial property that is at the base of the entire study. So what we find out is that beta is within these limits that you can see here. At a certain point upon deployment, the vertex A touch again the circle circumscribed to the flat configuration, intersect again the circle circumscribed to the flat initial configuration. And why is this important? Well, this means that at this point, the angle alpha is recovered in the projected XY plane. All right. So why is this important? Well, this means that if I take my my triangle and I tessellate to form a closed shape, in this case, it's a star shape, the simple geometric properties guarantee that this structure will also have a deployed geometrically compatible configuration, because we know that for a specific deployment height, the angle alpha is recovered. All right, so now I have a structure with two geometrically compatible configurations. Now, what in between? Well, any configuration in between is going to be geometrically incompatible. So it means that the faces are going to be a separate or overlap. And this here is highlighted by this red region. And we can geometrically quantify this geometric incompatibility. Now, how can we deal with this geometric incompatibility? Well, when we're going to go to the lab and we're going to fabricate this structure, this structure are going to make some material with some intrinsic flexibility. Whatever material we use has some flexibility, some compliance. And now we expect this compliance to absorb this geometric incompatibility through deformation. And so at the end of the day, what we expect this geometric property, this simple geometric property to lead to a bistable energy landscape. So an energy landscape with two minima, separated by an energy barrier caused by the deformation introduced by the geometric incompatibility. All right, so that's the idea. And now the question is, does this work? So first of all, let's explore a bit more the deployment of our triangle. So here I'm focused on specific triangle with alpha 30 degree and beta 33 degrees. And now what I'm plotting the geometric incompatibility as a function of the deployment height. And what we see is that there is a stable configuration, and then there is also another expanded geometrically compatible configuration characterized by zero geometric incompatibility. And in between, we see the incompatibility goes up and then comes down. All right, this is about the geometric incompatibility, but now what we want to solve a structure to be inflatable. And so what we do, we also monitor the volume underlying the triangle. And also for that, we have a closed form relation. And so what we see is that the volume, what we see is that an important feature is that the maximum volume in this case occurs before the expanded compatible structure. And what does this mean? Well, this means that the compatible expanded structure can never be reached by inflation, because when I'm inflating, I'm gonna stop here at the maximum volume. So is this a universal property? Well, what I can do, I can pick another triangle, in this case, alpha is 30 degrees and beta is 50 degrees. And what I see is that in this case, the configuration with maximum volume is after the expanded geometrically compatible configuration. But what we see is also in this case, the level of geometric incompatibility is much lower. So question, can you hear me or is everything frozen?
Everything is fine.
It's fine? Okay, good. Yeah. Good, good, good. All right. All right, so what we see is that in the second case, pretty much, the maximum volume occurs after the expanded compatible case. So we can see the structure is inflatable, but the geometric incompatibility is very low. So these were two special cases, but now, all this is based on simple geometry. So we have a analytical expression and we can easily scan the entire design space. So here I'm plotting the maximum geometric incompatibility for all possible triangles that have two geometrically compatible that recover the angle alpha at a certain point during deployment. And what we can see if it's to maximize geometric incompatibility, I need to choose triangle close to the upper boundary of the design domain. Now, how about inflatability? Well, we can introduce an inflation constraint. So what we can do, we report the deployment in the incompatibility volume space. And then what we take the ratio between the arc length, between the flat configuration and the maximum volume configuration, and between the flat and the expanded compatible configuration. And we want this ratio to be greater than 1. And now, so here, what we see when we look at the contour plot, we see that if we want the structure to be inflatable, we need to choose triangle also the lower boundary of the domain. And so here you see the contradiction, right? So by using a single triangle, it doesn't seem that we'll be able to design structures that are bistable and inflatable, because if I want to be bistable, I need to choose triangle close to the upper boundary domain. If I want to be inflatable, I need to choose triangle close to the lower boundary of the domain. So now, how can we get out of here? So what something we can try is try to combine different triangles. And for simplicity, we started by combining two triangles. And this is the first thing you can do, the simplest. You can arrange a triangle, two different triangles, so one is light purple and the other is dark purple, next to each other to form a star-like shape. And then you can put the two layers on top of each other to form a sort of a closed cavity. And what we can do, we can characterize the maximum incompatibility and deflation constraint for many, many designs. And here in this magenta marker, define the configuration for many, many different designs, define the property of many different designs that we consider. And now what we see is that as the And to be inflatable, and an important point, to be inflatable, we want to be on the right of this dash black line. So now, what do we see? We see that, I mean, as soon as the inflation constraint increases, the maximum incompatibilities goes down. And so now the question is, if design A that is highlighted here is the inflatable design with the maximum geometric incompatibility. Now the question is that enough to guarantee by stability? So to answer this question, we go to the lab and we fabricate the sample. And this is a sample at the centimeter length scale. So what we do, we 3D print the faces, and then we use plastic sheet to realize the hinges, and then we cover everything with a thin layer of EcoFlex to guarantee airtightness. And now you see we inflate, and then we remove the input, and what we see is that the structure pretty much goes back to the initial configuration. And the fact that there is no sign of bistability is also confirmed by the PV curve. So during this test, we also measure the pressure. And what we see is it's a monotonic pressure volume curves, and there is no sign whatsoever of bistability. All right, so this doesn't seem to work. So what can we do? Well, we can introduce a simple change. We can still go with this star-like structure, but instead of connecting the long edge of the triangle to the long edge of the other triangle, we can connect the long edge of the triangle to the short edge of the triangle. And by doing this, we can see that we can increase the geometric incompatibility. And now what we do, we choose design B, that is the inflatable design with the largest geometric incompatibility for this family of design. And we go to the lab and we build it. And now here you can see the experiment. And the movie doesn't play, but okay, now it's playing. So now we are inflating. And now you see we remove the input. And what you we find is the structure in this case retains the ploy shape. So this indicates that the structure is bistable. And also when we look at the PV curve here on the right, we see that it's non-monotonic and characterized by a negative region of pressure. So, and this confirms the bistability of the structure. Okay, so now we identify a structure, a strategy to realize bistable structure. But it's also limited to a specific family of shapes. So how can we expand the family of shapes that are possible? So something we can do, instead of arranging the triangles side to side, we can put them on top of each other to form this wedge-like structure that you can see here in yellow. And what we see is that this family of structure is characterized by even an higher geometric incompatibility. So now we are pretty sure, since we know that the geometric incompatibility associated with design B is enough to give us stability, given our fabrication strategy, the material that we use. At this point, we are pretty sure that this design with geometric incompatibility above that of B are going to be bistable. And here is we choose one, we choose design C. And now here is, you can see the movie during inflation. On the right, you can see the PV curve. We can see that we have a large region of negative pressure that again confirmed the bistability. And also in this case, in experiment, when we remove the input, the structure remains inflated. Okay, so we have another building block that another family of building blocks that are inflatable and bistable. So far, what we have been doing, we have been designing structures that have a flat configuration and an expanded stable configuration. But what we can do, we can also think about realizing structure with two expanded stable configuration. And to do this, what we can do, we can basically assume, we can look at the initially flat triangle as the projection on an initially rotated triangle. And if we do that, what we find is that we can, first of all, we can realize structure with two expanded geometrically compatible configuration. And second, in this case, there are one more degree of freedom, that is the initial rotation of the triangle. And by playing with that, what we can show, and here I spare you all the detail, if you're interested, you can find them in the paper, that we can realize bistable inflatable structure out of a single triangle by playing with this additional degree of freedom that we have. And now you can see that for this family structure, we can reach very large values of maximum incompatibility. And now Here you can see the initial configuration, you see the movie. And also in this case, we realize the structure in the lab and then we test it. And what we can see that this structure is again characterized by a very large region of negative pressure. So they are very stable. All right, so far so good. So what we have shown, we have basically identified different building blocks. And we have specifically focused on four building blocks comprising two triangles. And what we have seen are three of them can be made bistable and inflatable at the same time. But now at the beginning, I promise you functional structure, right? So the question is, how do we go from this building block to functional structures? Well, one strategy is to basically use these designs as building blocks. And so, for example, if we focus on design three, what we can do, we can pick up two bistable inflatable building blocks, slightly different, and then combine them, stagger them, to form an arch. And now this should give us an arch which basically is inflatable and bistable. And here you can see the realization of our arch. So this arch is like is larger than this the structure I showed before, it's at the meter scale. And this is made with corrugated plastic. And now we have deployed. And now David is taking away the input. And now this is, you know, this is pretty much the test to see whether it's bistable. And we see that the structure retaining shape. So this confirms the bistability of the structure. All right. So what else can we do? Well, we can also think about combining layer of different design to design functional structures. So for example, to design an inflatable shelter, we can use a layer of design one for the floor and a layer of design four for the, to define the habitat. And well, in the version that we fabricated, we further, we introduced several layers of design four. So we take a layer, then we trim it and we add another layer, specifically we have three layers. And this is for pure aesthetic reason. And so at the end of the day, what we expect to have an origami shape that is initially flat, and then it inflates, and it takes up the shape of a shelter. And even when we open door, it retains shape because of bistability. So let's see if this works. So here you can see David and Ben. So here is our structure. It's at a meter scale. Again, it's fabricated out of corrugated plastic. So now we connect the pump. We are providing input pressure. So you see that deploying. So now the roof is going to come up. All right. So now the structure is deployed. And now what we do, we open the door. And what we see is now the cavity is atmospheric pressure, but despite this, it retains shape because of the structural bistability that we imposed by design. And now when we want to, you know, we don't need the structure anymore, we attach it to vacuum, we flatten it. And it's ready to be moved. All right. So here is pretty much where we are with this project. There are still many elements we need to explore. The design we have identified are still, we don't have a robust strategy to investigate for the inverse design. So if you tell me I want this shape, right now the shape that we identify are guided by intuition. Also, right now, what we have is purely guided by geometry. So we don't have a mechanics model, for example, capable of predicting the forces that this structure can sustain. All right, so now we move to the second part of this talk, where we are going to look at an array of bistable origami units. And we'll try to investigate how this array can be exploited to design simple robotic systems. All right, so what you see here is one of the incredible robots that are designed and realized at Boston Dynamics. And you can see those robots are amazing. They can jump, they can run, they can do all sorts of crazy, crazy action. But on the other hand, you can also see these machines are extremely complex and extremely expensive. And the complexity of this traditional rigid robot in recent years has motivated the searches for inexpensive and simple flexible machines. And the advantage of clearly these machines are limited in the range of functionality they can achieve, but they also have advantages. For example, they're flexible, so they can easily handle delicate objects like as an egg. So you can see the example here on the right. They're also extremely easy to fabricate, extremely inexpensive. They have been used both to achieve locomotion as well to basically interact with humans for in terms of medical devices. And here you can see this example here and there, where soft actuators are used to realize rehabilitation devices. Now, clearly in recent years, great progress has been made in soft robotics community, but there are still challenges that remain. So, and specifically here, I want to target two challenges. First of all, as I mentioned at the beginning, typically these actuators have a quite linear PV curve. And so it means that at a certain pressure, they can only get a certain, they are only basically get a certain deformation. And then this deformation can be amplified as you increase the pressure. And now the question is, can we, for example, design actuator that can achieve different, very distinct deform configuration when actuated with a single input? And the second question is also regarding locomotion. So if you look at the focus on the example here in the center, you see that there are multiple tubes going into this simple robot that is able to move. And why is this? Well, it's because this robot comprises 5 actuators specifically. And those need to be activated as according to a specific sequence in order to get locomotion. And so now our question is, can we design a robot that can move when actuated with a single input? So where the sequence is created automatically without the need for us to provide it by external input, but where the structure somehow provide the sequence. All right. And to answer this question, again, we turn to origami, inflatable bistable origami. So this is a project led by my student, by my postdoc Anto, and my student David, and my postdoc Ben. And so specifically, we focus on a Kreisling pattern. And here you can see, and again, we made it inflatable. And this pattern can be made for certain choice, a geometric parameter can be made bistable. But for the specific parameter we chose, it's not bistable, it's monostable. So you see, we inflate, it's expand, it twists, expand, then we deflate, it twists back, and it's basically and it's coming back and it's shrinking. All right, so this is our building block. And now we are interested in bistability, right? So how do we make it bistable? The way we make it bistable is by further dividing one of the panels. So we take one of the panel comprising 2 triangles and we further divide it to make it out of 4 triangles. And here you can see the panel highlighted, it's highlighted in orange in the movie that's playing. So, and by creating, by introducing this additional fold, we create a 4 node vertex that is known to lead, to potentially lead to bistability. And so what we see when we have such a bistable panel is when we further increase at a certain point, this panel pop out. Now it's pop out. And then when we deflate, we see initially the panel remains out. And so we break rotational symmetry, so the unit bend. And then eventually it's popping back and the structure completely failed. All right. So here you can see the state diagram for the monostable structure. So we go up and down. And here is the state diagram for the bistable structure in which we have introduced this bistable panel. And we see that if we inflate large enough, then the panel snap, pop out. And so we go from state 0 to state 1. And then as we deflate, since initially the panel remain in the pop-out position, pop-up position, we see the circular symmetry is broken. And so we see that the structure bend and eventually then complete flat. All right, so completely flattened because at a certain point the panel is snapped back. So now we can control the pressure at which the panel snap and snap back by tuning the position of the central vertex of this 4 node vertex. And specifically, we define delta, the distance of the vertex from the initial hinge. And we explore 3 different distances, 2, 3, and 4 millimeter. And we see that by changes, by increasing this distance, we can increase the pressure threshold with the snapping of the panel, of course, both during inflation and also the snapback during deflation. As for the maximum bending angle, we see that this is not much affected by delta because it's mostly controlled by the contact between the rigid faces. All right. And so now, you know, we can build in this case, the prototype has 3D printed. We can build different building, different module with different delta. We can inflate, we can deflate, we can take picture, and we can measure both the bending, the twist, and the displacement from this experiment. And then now that we carefully characterize the deformation from the experiment, you know, we can think about, so now we have a building block, it's fully characterized. What we can think about is stacking them together to realize, and our idea is, can we, by stacking them together, can we realize assembly with interesting functionality? So, all right, when we stack them together, we have, first of all, we have building block with different level of stability that we can control by tuning delta. We can also control the orientation of the faults, so the chirality start of the building block, and we can put them going counterclockwise or counterclockwise. And another parameter we can play is the position of the bistable panel. So we can put the bistable panel on different faces. And so here, just for example, is a 2-unit actuator. So we stack just 2 units. And in this case, 1 unit has a delta of 2 mm, the other of a delta of 4 mm. And in one, we put the bistable, the position bistable panel is highlighted in color, yellow and blue. And here is, you know, that what we can do. Basically, you know, we know that the 2 units should also share the same pressure because they are connected together. And so purely by using our geometry, the characterization from the single unit, we can build the state diagram, right? Because we know that the units share the same volume, the same pressure, sorry. And then what we can do, we can also go in the lab and, you know, connect 2 units and build the prototype. And we see that clearly, you know, it behaves as it should. And what we can do, since we are interested in building actuator, we can also characterize the position of the end phase for all different stable configuration and for different transition. And so here is what the characterization is, what you see on the plot here on the right. And what we see is that most of the configuration are straight, so are characterized by an angle equal to 0. So it means that actuator remains straight. But we see that during deflation, there are also a configuration characterized by an angle of 20 degrees. So this gives us indication that by, you know, this bistability and the fact that during when this bistable panel pop out during deflation, we introduce some bending, give us opportunity to realize actuator capable also of bending. All right. And now how do we go from here to a robotic arm? For example, what we would like to design is an actuator that is capable of reaching these 3 different targets, T1, T2, T3. And these are arbitrary chosen targets. Well, what we can do, we can use our database and combine it with a simple optimization algorithm. Specifically, we use a greedy algorithm. So identify the configuration that leads to the minimum error that can better approach these 3 different targets at 3 different levels of pressure. And we see that in this case, the minimum error is obtained for a configuration with 12 actuators. And here is you can see here the configuration predicted by our algorithm. All right. And here is the state diagram for this actuator comprising 12 units. And so what we see is if we inflate above P4 and then we deflate, we first reach T1. Then what we need to do, we need to reset the actuator and then to inflate above P4 and then deflate to reach T2 and then T3. All right, these are the prediction. Let's see if it works. So here you see our actuator. We arrange the building block according to follow the design predicted by optimization algorithm. So now we have been inflated, now deflated, and now we reach T1. Now what we are gonna do, we are gonna reset the actuator. So we go below P4 and then we reset it. And now we go above P4. We inflate it again, and now we deflate it to reach T2. And now when we further deflate, we reach C3. So what is interesting about this actuator is we are operating with a single pressure, but even with a single pressure and a tubular structure, we can reach very different, by carefully choosing the pressure and the pressure history, we can reach very different trajectories. And typically, instead for actuator that are currently used, you only have one trajectory available and you only move on one trajectory. And here we are able basically to reach different trajectory by exploiting this by stability. So all this all good. So now we have a sort of a robotic arm capable of reaching three target configuration in this case. But now for this specific case, what you've seen is that basically we need to reset the initial state between targets. And now for many robotic applications, this is not desired because it would like to have a closed loop. And what we can do, we can have additional constraint on optimization by requesting that the target point are reached sequentially without resetting between. And this gives us closed loop that can be leveraged for robotic locomotion, for example. So here is a very simple example. So to propel a robot, for example, we take inspiration from the closed trajectory of a rowing stroke. And so we would like an actuator that goes between T1, T2, straight, T1, T2, straight, T1, T2. And, you know, we provide this as an input for our optimization algorithm. And in this case, we find that an actuator comprising 3 building blocks is optimal. And in this case, we see we need to pressurize above P4. And then when we deflate, we first reach T1 and then T2. And what we want to do is use this for locomotion. So what we do, we put 2 of these actuators on the chassis. We also connect rod to the end of the actuator to amplify the motion. And then, so the idea is when we reach T1, the rod is going to touch the ground, and then as we move between T1 to T2, it's going to provide a stroke. And here is the, you see, basically, we keep pressurizing and vacuuming. And then we see that this loop that we engineer enable our simple robot to move forward. All right. So this leads me to the conclusion. So I hope I convince you that Bistable Element offer a promising platform to design mechanical system within model functionality, and specifically today focus on the global structure and robotic system. But I'm sure there are many more out there that are waiting to be explored. And if you're interested in the result I presented, you can find more detail. Here are the paper where you can find more detail. To be honest, the first paper just got published. The second is still under review, but we hope it will be soon. And that's all I have, and I'm happy, very happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Katia, for this very nice talk. So we have we have time for questions. So just please come with your question, or if you don't have a microphone, you can eventually ask the question in the chat.
Thank you.